I already mentioned that we are in our sixth Palm Sunday service at Believers. I know that doesn't seem like a big number or a long time frame, but from the very beginning, as I was just looking around this building and looking around the different faces, that it's a big deal that you're here today. It's a big deal that what God is doing in this little small community, it's making a world impact. And so thank you for being a part of it. When it comes to holiday messages, I'm just going to be transparent with you. I have really struggled. And I'll tell you why. Because when I prepare for a message, it's super important to me that it be something that God has deposited within me. It's got to be fresh. It's got to be alive in me. It's got to be a truth that that overflows from me. And sometimes when it comes to a holiday weekend, I feel boxed in. I feel like, well, I'm forced to teach on this. Or not that it's bad to teach on Palm Sunday or Easter or Christmas, but there's a pressure too about all the great ministry gifts over the centuries who have done it so much better than me. And I've got to deliver a message that's going to compare. And so I started wondering, is it just me? I mean, am I the only pastor that's worried about these or gets tensious about these things? And I'm not. I know for sure because I called some. I'm like, y'all have some trouble with this too. Please tell me yes. Just lie to me if you don't. So then we talk about Palm Sunday. I had that same tensious pressure coming up this week in preparation. And the Lord encouraged me this morning. This is an opportunity for us, to those that have been around church for a while, those that have been around this holiday for a while. One of the dangers that we can get into in any relationship at all is to lose our curiosity. You know, between a husband and a wife, as soon as you lose curiosity, you stop chasing, and then it's a downward cycle from there. As soon as you and I think that we know everything there is to know about the scriptures, about anything pertaining to the kingdom, it's a downward cycle. It's troubling when someone says to me, oh, I've heard that message before, as if there's nothing more to extract from it. And so this morning, for you, I'm praying, even if you've been around church culture most of your life and you've been around these holiday messages for most of your life, do like I did this week. Lord, show me something. Reveal to me something that I didn't already know, or remind me of a truth that I need to have deposited today. It also is my goal as I look around the service and over the following one, this is our second of three this weekend, there will be people, and there are people in the services that don't know the depths or the history of what we're even celebrating. After the first service this morning, I had multiple people come up to me and were just floored at the understanding of the history and what it meant and how it was more than just ceremony and it was more than just another Christian event on our Christian calendars. There's power in this. One of the things that we must know, and we understand this when it comes to American history, in order to develop and move forward, we can't forget where we've come from or we're destined to repeat it. We also need to know our heritage. Why are we doing the things we're doing? Why are we calling this Palm Sunday? Well, it's fair to call it Palm Sunday because the event that happened on this day. What we're going to read in a few moments is that Jesus entered Jerusalem and people began to wave palm branches and lay them on the ground. And it got caught on as the celebration, the week leading up to the Passover, is Palm Sunday. So it is my goal to both minister to the ones that are hungry and interested in the history and revealing what some of these timeless truths are. And I'm praying that those that, like me, you've been around these messages for a while, that you leave here encouraged and there'd be at least a nugget that we can humbly say, you know what, that was something I didn't know. So let's dive in. My goal is to create within your imagination a vision of what was taking place all those years ago. In Jerusalem, this was the most crazy, hectic, busy week at Jerusalem time. There were three feasts. Festivals that were required for Jews to make pilgrimages back to the city in order to celebrate or do sacrifices. This one, the Passover, was one of them. The city usually operated around 25,000 people as their population, but during this week, it would swell to more than 100,000 people. Now, just to give you a visual aid as to what that might look like, that would be like the entire population of Eaton County, approximately 108,000, converging on the city of Grand Ledge, approximately 8,000, for 1 week. All of them needing food, all of them needing a place to stay, all of them being crammed into spaces that they don't normally live at or are accustomed to. And in fairness, it's not even a real image because Grand Ledge is much more spread out than what we're going to see here at Jerusalem was. So as I already mentioned, it was demanded by the law of Moses that they had to come. They were coming, some of them, from hundreds of miles, making a pilgrimage to Jerusalem. This was to celebrate the Passover. For those of you that aren't familiar with what the Passover is, the 10 plagues that God brought on Egypt, the final one was the death angel. God gave the direction to Moses to tell each one to cover their door with the blood of a lamb. And that each person which that blood covered, the death angel would go by. And if that person or household that did not, their firstborn son would be killed. And so they were celebrating the Passover year after year. So this continue on. Jerusalem, as I already mentioned, was not that big of a city. And it was very difficult to get to. It sits about 2,500, actually specifically 2,550 feet above sea level. It was the first mile high city. It was not easy to get to. It's elevated. There's small paths and trails. This would have been very crowded even getting there. There would have been literally caravans of people and people coming from all over making their way up this very difficult terrain. Now, as they made their way up the terrain, one of the poetic statements used by the psalmist in Psalm 48, verse 2, called it a beautiful in elevation, the joy of the whole world. As one historian wrote, no visitor seeing Jerusalem for the first time could fail to be impressed by its visual splendor. The long, difficult ascent from Jericho to the holy city ended as the travelers rounded the Mount of Olives and suddenly caught sight of a vista like few others in the world. Across the Kidron Valley, set among the surrounding hills, was Jerusalem, the perfection of beauty. In the words of Lamentations, the joy of all the world. The view from the Mount of Olives was dominated by the gleaming or the reflection of gold off from the temple. And what wasn't covered in gold was pure white of like limestone that was reflecting. The center of the city was, it was engulfed by the size and the beauty of this temple. I'd like to bring up an image, though this isn't exactly what it looks like from the Mount of Olives, but this is how dominating the size of the temple is inside the city. That would be your first view as you rounded the Mount of Olives. The city, surrounded by a thick wall, a gray wall, that was about 4 miles in circumference and bringing in about a square mile of the city. There were random and periodic gates, large gates around the city. And inside each gate was a customs station where publicans or tax collectors would tax people for the amount of goods they brought into the city. They'd also tax them for the amount of value or goods that they left the city with. The city was divided right down the middle. One side was called the lower side or the north side of the city. And the other one was the upper side of the city, also referred to in that time as Zion. If you could please bring up the next image. You see, the lower side was the more congested side. This was an area of small, typically two-story homes, mud in color. It was crowded, filled with very narrow, unpaved streets going up and down all over the place. It was busy, noisy. This was mostly where the skilled tradespeople were, such as the weavers and the dyers, the potters, the bakers. There was tailors, open markets with fresh produce. There were people selling souvenirs and even jewelers. But on the other side, the upper side, which you see is more sprawling, that was entirely different. That's where the most wealthy and the rich lived. There were very wide avenues, paved roads. The homes were marble and spread out in beautiful courts and private pools. This was a space that was not very crowded and not very noisy. Elegant, to say the least. Now, going back to the congested part of this city, there's a reason for this background. I think it's important for us to understand, to set the environment, to understand what Jesus was entering into, or our Jewish brothers and sisters. The noise and the chaos of bleeding animals. You see, since the journey was very difficult, some people came hundreds of miles, it would have been more challenging to bring your sacrificial lamb. Many, in fact, most, would have waited to the city to buy one. Imagine now there's more than 100,000 people. People are having to get their animals, and so the city is overflowing with sacrificial animals. The noise, the bleeding of these animals making noise would be deafening, The stenches would be quite mixed too. There'd be blood everywhere, blood-drenched clothes from the priests that are sacrificing animals, and with all of those animals, for those of you all who grew up on a farm or at least are familiar with the smell of a farm, imagine tens of thousands of lambs. So this was what's happening. Now, all of the chaos, all of the noise, you've got all of these animals, everyone's converging, there's a lot of energy, there's a lot of tension. Imagine, if you will, a procession that begins to make its way into the city, and it's not the one that you might be thinking. Because the overcrowding and the excitement of the festivals, they frequently led to outbreaks of violence and anti-Roman rebellion. The governor frequently made it his norm to be at each of these. He made his presence there with extra soldiers stationed in periodic places around the city as to be ready for any type of uprising of anti-Roman protesters. This lavish procession was specifically designed to impress people and to discourage any potential uprising with a very visual persuasion of empire or imperial impressive by their imperial power. That's the word I was looking for. So this is what it would look like as the city begins to part, making way for an entire cavalry of horses. There were foot soldiers, leather armor, helmets and weapons, banners and golden eagles placed on top of poles as they made their way through the center of the city, making sure that everyone saw their might and their presence. Now, on the other side of the city, another procession begins, much different than this one. Down from the Mount of Olives, Jesus and his humble procession make their way into the city. No pomp, no ceremony, dressed simply like the people, riding on a donkey. But this time, the city erupts in praise. Now, as we go there, I'm going to begin to read in Matthew 21. Imagine Jesus had just the other day raised Lazarus from the dead. So there's all kinds of buzz going on about that. There's people that have been watching for Jesus. There's been people that have heard rumor of him being there. Some of those have known personally people that have been raised from the dead or healed or all these signs and wonders. There's quite an electricity happening. And then there he is. Jesus makes his way into the city. Matthew 21, verse number 6. The disciples went and did as Jesus had instructed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and placed their cloaks on them for Jesus to sit on. A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, with others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. The crowds that went ahead of them and those that followed shouted, "Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord! Hosanna in the highest heaven!" When Jesus entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred and asked, "Who is this?" The crowds answered, "This is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth in Galilee." Now, there's already nervousness among the governor and his soldiers. That I'm confident they weren't getting the praise that Jesus just got. And they start shouting stuff about being the king. There's tension in this building in the city. And though the whole city's encased in about a 1 square mile, the majority of this collection of people is already in a congested area with small roads. So this would be very noticeable. Now in Mosaic culture, under the Mosaic law, you were required to bring a lamb or have a lamb for a sacrifice on the Passover. And it had to be selected 5 days in advance. Jesus, the ultimate Lamb of God, enters Jerusalem today, 5 days in advance of the Passover. It's powerful. The Lamb of God that would present himself to the temple is exactly what had to happen. You had to bring your sacrificial lamb to the temple so they could be inspected and reviewed, that it's non-blemished, and it's saw by everybody before it happens. And so Jesus, following suit, the one true lamb, he makes his way to the temple, and for the next 3 days, he begins to teach in the temple. But on the first day, he clears it. Why would Jesus clear the temple? Well, there's two times that we read that Jesus cleared the temple. Both of them, I personally believe that neither one of them are connected. They're for different reasons and different purposes. I look forward to teaching on the first one. This one, because of where I came from and the group that I used to be associated with, we loved this part about Jesus. Man, it only fortified our image of God that was just looking to get people. Man, Jesus went in there, he's kicking things over and driving people out. Before I read this to you, can I just ask you this? I'm going to give you the answer first so that you look really spiritual to the person next to you. So you're just going to want to, nod like this or like this, okay? The answer is, so let's practice. Come on, you'll have more coffee than the 8:30 service. Let's practice. Very good. You look really spiritual. Would God ask you to do something in your life that he himself would not do? Very good. Very good. Now, let's look at what Jesus did, and I'm going to explain why that's so important. Matthew 21, verse 12, Jesus entered the temple courts and drove out all of that were buying and selling there. He overturned the tables of the money changers and the benches of those selling doves. It is written, he said to them, my house will be called a house of prayer, but you are making it a den of robbers. So if God would not ask us to do something that he wouldn't do himself, then we need to go back to what the Apostle Paul writes in Ephesians 6. We do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against spiritual principalities and rulers in high places. Okay? That's important because Jesus was not in there beating up on Pharisees and clearing the place because he was against people. This was a spiritual thing. So what was the spiritual thing? There was corruption going on. You'll notice that they said that he went into the courts. The court area was the only place that Gentiles, that's non-Jews, could actually go. And the Pharisees and the high priests and those that were overseeing the temple had filled the outer court with sacrificial animals, literally making no room for those who might be seeking God to come. That's the first thing. The second thing, the corruption that Jesus was dealing with, was that the high priest had to approve the sacrifice. Take your lamb, check it out, make sure it's not blemished, and give a stamp of approval on it. What they were doing was intentionally telling people who had bought one, nope, that one doesn't pass. You need to buy a different one. And guess what? They went and bought one from someone that was putting money in their pocket. It was corrupt. Jesus wasn't against them. He was trying to stop the corruption within the priesthood. Now, the priest in this day, there were three primary types of priest. There was one that was the everyday priest that really Jesus never speaks of. The other type was the chief priest or the high priest. They're the aristocrat class. And then there was the high priest, rather. Caiaphas was the high priest in Jesus' day. So the chief priests, they were in Rome's pocket. Power and money. They were the ones that the Roman government allowed to run the city so long as they could maintain peace. So the chief priests, their goal was to keep everybody in order because if peace was disrupted, Rome, the empire would come in and just remove them from what they were doing. They would lose their power and lose their authority. And Jesus was really messing with their system. So there was the Pharisees. This is the other type of priest. This was a religio-political, I didn't even know that word existed until like 4 days ago, religio-political party in Jerusalem. The Pharisees were the most powerful political party in that city. The other were the scribes. The scribes were teachers of the law, and they aligned with the Pharisees. They fiercely opposed Jesus. And though they weren't part of the three types of priests, there was the fourth kind, the presbyters, or otherwise known as the elders. The elders, along with the chief priests, the scribes, and the Pharisees, made up a court system called the Sanhedrin. The Sanhedrin was a court that convened and judged matters both religious and legal. They considered it their job to guard Jewish religious and political life, all with an eye on Rome. They wanted to make sure every judgment would keep them in good graces with the Roman Empire because they didn't want to lose their power and authority. So Jesus spent Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday teaching in the temple, presenting himself to all that could see that he was indeed the spotless Lamb of God. Wednesday, Jesus and his disciples leave the city. Now, if you have your Bibles or you're taking notes, go with me to Matthew chapter 26, verse I'm going to begin reading in verse number 1. Matthew 26, verse number 1. Now it came to pass when Jesus had finished all these sayings that he said to his disciples, "You know that after 2 days is the Passover, and the Son of Man will be delivered up to be crucified. Then the chief priests, the scribes, and the elders of the people assembled at the palace of the high priest, who was called Caiaphas, and plotted to take Jesus by trickery and kill him. But they said, not during the feast, lest there be an uproar among the people. And when Jesus was in Bethany at the house of Simon the leper, a woman came to him having an alabaster flask of very costly fragrant oil and poured it on his head as he sat at the table. But when his disciples saw it, they were indignant, saying, why this waste? For the fragrant oil might have been sold for much and given to the poor. Jesus was aware of it, and he said to them, why do you trouble the woman? For she has done a good work for me. For you have the poor with you always, but me you do not have always. Watch this. For in pouring this fragrant oil on my body, she did it for my burial. Jesus had left the city now, was being anointed for what was to come. Assuredly, I say to you, verse 13, wherever this gospel is preached in the whole world, that this woman has done will also be told as a memorial to her. Verse 14 goes on to say that one of his men, Judas, would leave there and go and betray him, getting him prepared to be handed over to the Sanhedrin. Now Thursday has come. So we've entered the city 5 days prior. First 3 days he's preaching. Well, I should start off. The first day he cleanses the temple. 2 more days after that he's preaching. He goes out of the city to be anointed, prepared for burial. In the morning on Thursday, Jesus sends Peter and John to Jerusalem to secure the upper room for the Passover meal. Between 12 o'clock noon and 5 o'clock in the evening, the sacrifices had to be brought to the priest and the sacrifices made. Then the lambs were brought home, roasted, and no bone was to be broken, and they were to eat the entire thing. Now that's an important aspect for you and I to understand, because not only is it a type and shadow, an imagery of Jesus, in the original Passover, they were instructed to take the lamb and to bring it into their homes and to eat the whole lamb. There are some portions of the lamb that really would be tough for me to eat. Yet they were instructed to eat the whole lamb. Where's the connector? Because there's parts of the gospel that are also difficult for me to digest, even though I need the whole lamb. I can't just pick and choose the highlights and the things that are just going to bless me or be easy for me. I need, and you need, the whole lamb. Friday. Friday was considered the sundown on Thursday, and the sacrificial meal took place. This was a major, major conversation that I'm not sure that us outside of this custom really understand the gravity or magnitude of what Jesus is about to tell these guys. Look with me at Matthew 26, verse number 26. They're getting prepared now to eat the sacrificial lamb. While they were eating, Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body." Then he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. I tell you, I will not drink from this fruit of the vine from now until that day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom." When they had sung a hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. Now, we're not provided with the benefit of the writers indicating what their facial expressions would be like, but I have to imagine that as soon as Jesus begins to say that this is a new covenant, you're eating my body. We have the benefit of knowing the rest of the story, but they're hearing it for the first time. Their thought had to go, are we getting cannibalism here? Right? So then, before missing a beat, he says, "And this is my blood of the new covenant." Their jaws had to hit the floor. Their eyes had to bulge out of their head. Do you understand what he's saying? that the system that they've known their whole life, Jesus reinterprets it and says, that system is coming to an end. There's a new covenant here today, and you're starting it right now. Has anyone ever been told or taught or saw something in Scripture, a revelation that scared you? Like, could that really be true? Is it really biblical? That's the kind of magnitude of what they're hearing. I mean, nobody would talk like this. That's an important aspect for you and I, because this is the reason that Jesus came. I've been a Christian now for just over 25 years. I've been a minister for just over 16. And I can tell you, up until about 7 or 8 years ago, I can testify that the majority of my experience, no, I'm going to say all of my experience, and the majority of people that I've come into contact with have very little concept of what covenant means. Most think that it's the start here, that the old covenant just kind of continues right on into the new, without understanding that it changed in Jesus. Now, I'm growing in this understanding, and I teach it frequently. I'm looking forward to another year from now, or 2 years, or a decade from now, when I'm really got a better understanding of it. But sometimes it's hard to get my pea brain around the magnitude of what this really means. This was the prophetic answer that Jesus came to fulfill. Look with me at Jeremiah chapter 31. While you're either writing that down or turning that, I want to point out a couple key phrases. I don't want to miss this point. Jesus said this is a new covenant, a better covenant, and look at the phrases that he uses. He says, take, eat. That means that you're not being forced to eat it, that you have to receive it. Your encounter with Christ is not being forced on you. You're going to have to receive it. Eat. All of us need to eat in order to live. If you want to live an abundant life that God has provided for us in Jesus, we're going to have to eat of the bread of life that is Christ. And not to mention, eating is something that I have to do for myself. I can't have someone eat for me and expect to get the nutrients out of it. There are no grandchildren in the kingdom of God. What's that mean? Just because daddy's in it doesn't mean you are. Just because grandma grew up in the church and walked with Jesus does not mean that you automatically are. Now, thank God for faithful grandmas. A lot of us are here today because a faithful grandma or a faithful mama was praying. Amen. Amen. But I'm saying that you must eat for yourself. You must consume for yourself. Now, here's the last part. He says he gave thanks. The Greek word for give thanks is Eucharist. I've had many people in traditional backgrounds and other denominations ask me, do we partake in Eucharist? The answer is yes, we give thanks, and we believe that as we take communion that Jesus really did what he said he would do, and he proved it by his body. He proved it by pouring out his blood. Amen? We give thanks. Okay, now I'm caught up. Jeremiah 31, verse number 31. The days are coming, declares the Lord. This is the prophetic word. When I will make a new covenant with the people of Israel and with the people of Judah, it will not be like the covenant I made with their ancestors. Someone say not. It's not a continuation. It's not like the first one. And for fairness sake, unless you're a Jew, that covenant wasn't for you either. Thank you, Jesus. It will not be like the covenant I made with their ancestors. When I took them by the hand, I led them out of Egypt because they broke my covenant, though I was a husband to them, declares the Lord. This is the covenant I will make with the people of Israel after that time, declares the Lord. I will put my law in their minds, and I will write it on their hearts. I will be their God, and they will be my people. No longer will they teach their neighbor or say to one another, know the Lord, because they will all know me. From the least of them to the greatest, declares the Lord, for I will forgive their wickedness and will remember their sins no more. That's powerful. This new covenant was not something that was externally covering any longer. It was an internal change that now was brought on by a different, better covenant, prophesied not only by Jeremiah, but multiple times of this new and better covenant. The spotless Lamb of God internally cleansed us, not just externally covered us. Again, I confess to you, I teach the covenants. I teach the finished work of Jesus, and I still I still know there's more that I need to understand about this. And it makes me nervous too because, man, I need to really depend on the Holy Spirit to lead me. Sometimes I feel like we as Christians would prefer to have a list of rules to follow so at least we know we're doing it right. But God wants us to be free to follow him where he would lead us. Boundaries are important, don't get me wrong, and this is where we have tension. But I want to say this about boundaries and pain and punishment. Boundaries are a gift from God. Pain is an indicator that you've stepped out of the safety. If you leave this place, like I'm going to leave this place today at some point, and I'm going to get out on I-96 and I'm going to head back towards Lansing area, I've got two options. I can get on with traffic, or I can make the mistake of going against traffic. If I go against traffic, do you think that might have a detriment to my health? How about the health of people around me? But if I cooperate with the flow of traffic, man, the blessing is there. I'm going to get exactly where I want to be. You see, when we disobey, we step outside of the boundaries. We bring pain and discouragement, even death. So boundaries, by God's help, are good. But he wants us to cooperate with what he's followed us, or what he's provided for us. Let's look at one final verse as we wrap up. Hebrews chapter 10, verse number 11. I hope I didn't lose half you on that last part of it. Hebrews 10, 11. Day after day, every priest stands and performs his religious duties again and again. He offers the same sacrifices, which can never take away sins. They never. They could never take them away. They only covered. But when this priest, speaking of Jesus, had offered for all time one sacrifice for sins, he sat down at the right hand of God. And since that time, he waits for his enemies to be made his footstool, for by one sacrifice, he has made perfect forever those who are being made holy. You see, old covenant, I needed to do something out here to try to create an internal change or an internal change. And Jesus flipped it over. He says, I'm going to change your heart, and all of this outside stuff, behavior, is going to catch up with what I've already done on the inside. Jesus came for this purpose. Jesus came to the city knowing what was coming for him. On this week that he went through, which we'll pick up next weekend, on Friday and what took place, and the resurrection that made it all better, Jesus, on one event, was crucified on a cross, but it took him more than 33 years to be entirely crucified. That is, it took him more than 33 years to redo everything that Adam had broken. And the final blow was Jesus' death on Friday. But that's a good thing. That's why we call it Good Friday and not Bad Friday. Because Jesus has fixed it all. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Would you stand? We'd like to pray over you. Father, we're grateful today that your pursuit, your love, has reached out to us right where we are at. That your sacrifice, your love, your body that was broken, your blood that was poured out, wasn't just another sacrifice over the decades and centuries. It was the sacrifice that today, as we cooperate with you and we surrender our hearts and lives to you, that newness of life comes, abundant life, Zoe life. Father, I pray that over each one of us, that you lead us to a place of surrender. Right now, before you, we ask that you would transform the way we think. We surrender the authority to you. For some, it's the first time. For others, it's the handing back of the reins. We need you to lead our lives. We want to follow you. We thank you that there's great power and freedom and liberty in trusting you. As a result, Lord, we are expecting great things to happen, not just for us, but through us, that as we leave this place, may this be a week of encounter, a week of influence. Lord, that those that you've placed in our lives to bless and encourage, that we would be bold enough to show your love, your goodness. We bear the name of Christ with immense gratitude. We are so grateful today to be called sons and daughters, not slaves. Sons and daughters. We love you. We bless you in Jesus' name. Amen.